How do you get delicious, home-cooked, fresh food on the table every day? By keeping things simple.
It's a pretty, pretty picture.
Being savvy with five ingredients is a fantastic way to make cooking quick, easy, and good for your wallet.
Exciting, surprising food made out of really great value ingredients.
From hearty mains...
So classic? No. Clever? I think yes.
...to lovely lunches...
The crunch is so good.
...and decadent desserts.
It feels like an exciting thing that you can bring to the table.
With just a few store cupboard staples, we can get the maximum value out of just five ingredients.
Kofta-inspired meatballs with that lovely tzatziki that we've ramped up.
Just look at that.
No compromises, just delicious dishes that are quick, easy and packed full of flavour.
That's five ingredients working brilliantly.
This time, I've got a roast dinner all cooked in one pot. To cut down on the washing up, but not on the flavour.
It's dripping with juice.
My version of a speedy carbonara that can use up whatever veg you have to hand.
Silky smooth, elegant.
The flavour is massive.
Two ways to use pre-packed ingredients to make crowd-pleasing starters or sides.
Oh, that is another level of delicious.
And I've called on two connoisseurs of Middle Eastern cuisine to show us how store cupboard spices can transform everyday ingredients into mouth-watering meals.
You won't believe it's five
and
ingredients.
Vegetarian.
And vegetarian.
I mean, come on.
So I'm going to give you another way to cook beautiful chicken. This is an ingredient that many of us buy every week. Roast chicken, chicken and chips. I love that, but this is a pot-roasted chicken with potatoes and garlic, the most incredible vivid green sauce, and this is a brilliant way to get those Mediterranean flavours into your everyday chicken dish.
Just five simple ingredients can be transformed into this brilliant pot-roast chicken. Cooked on the hob and the oven, you get the double whammy of succulent meat and beautifully crispy skin for four people. Served with a delicious Mediterranean-inspired sauce, this chicken dinner is a total treat.
So look, it all starts here in a pan, and cooking it in one pan really helps you amplify flavour. We're going to get flavour out of that carcass that will almost create a stock that cooks into the potatoes. The skin will go crispy here, but it'll be soft, succulent. It will melt in your mouth. So I'm going to whack this onto a medium heat. I'll add just a little bit of olive oil, just enough to sort of lubricate the bottom of the pan. I'm going to go in with a nice chicken. This will go straight into the pan with its kind of breast facing up at the moment. 5 minutes to brown it up beautifully, right? It starts in a pan, then goes in the oven. It's perfect because in that 5 minutes, we can peel our potatoes. Kilo of potatoes. And these aren't really going to be a roast potato. They're going to be like a cross between roast, baked, and a fondant potato. So, pot roasting versus roasting. Roasting is in a tray. There's more direct heat, more crispiness. But what you get by doing pot roasting, you have a snug environment. It's gonna amplify more moisture, more juiciness. So it's like a kind of cross between stewing and roasting. And particularly if you've got tougher cuts of meat, it works really, really well. So look, I can smell and hear that good things are happening. Let's have a little look. Yeah. Sizzling, nice bit of colour. So now we go on to the side, like that. As you're turning the chicken around, you know, the skin might bust and break. It doesn't matter, OK? Because it's all going to be part of this beautiful flavour and texture that you're going to create by pot roasting. Just go on the side there like that. It's looking lovely. So, what I'm going to do is grab a knife, cut the potatoes into 5 centimetre chunks, bold and big. You want them to hold their shape. So look, we've had that chicken coloured on all four sides. Let's just take it out for a second. Left in the pan, we've got the olive oil and the chicken fat. Now, first up, a bulb of garlic. Be brave. In the Mediterranean, they love garlic. I'm going to steal just one of the smaller cloves. That's going to be for this incredible little Spanish-inspired salsa that's going to finish this dish. But the rest of this, put into the fat, and by cooking them whole in the skin, you get a sweet, perfumed, delicate garlic flavour. Angle the pan and just carefully pop that garlic into that fat. Then I'm going to use the top of this parsley for this amazing Spanish-inspired sauce, and I'm going to use the stalks here to go in with the garlic. Then we're going to go in with the beautiful potatoes. So just mix it up like that. Turn the heat up and just half cover them in some boiling water. Parboil the potatoes in that water. It's got the garlic, the parsley, the chicken fats, so it's sucking up all of that. So look, once this has had about 5-10 minutes, we're gonna go back in with the chicken. So just snuggle it in right to the bottom of the pan. You wanna be able to see the potatoes up the side, get that garlic up the side like that. So an hour and a quarter in the oven at 180 degrees Celsius, which is 350 Fahrenheit. The top of that chicken and the top of the potatoes will go golden and baked and gorgeous. So look, let the oven do all the hard work now. Brilliant. So to contrast that beautifulness, garlic, crispy skin, lovely potatoes, I want something that's really like vivacious and electric and taking inspiration from the Mediterranean, right? In that whole area, we've got salsa verde, pea stew, we've got flavoured oils. All of these oil herb-based sauces are a joy. I'm doing kind of an expression of that. So we're gonna take this wodge of parsley, right? A big old wodge. Now it could be basil, it could be tarragon, it could be marjoram, any chosen herb. This is a principal style recipe. Well, I'm gonna use parsley because it's fresh, irony, and vivid green. So first up, a pinch of salt. Pound it up. Now you could just use a knife and finely chop it. You could use a little liquidizer, right? I like it old school. Break the herb up. I'm gonna take that garlic clove. So just one clove is more than enough. So we're gonna pound that into the parsley. Parsley and garlic, best friends. And then we're gonna go nuts. You could use almonds, you could use pine nuts, pistachios, but just a handful of hazelnuts are delicious. What I quite like to do is take, you know, let's say half of these nuts to, you know, like a paste, so they're really creamy. And then the other half, kind of, you can crack half, quarter, but have a little bit of texture there as well. So just use a couple of tablespoons of olive oil to loosen all of this up. Sauces like this are really good for using up any leftover herbs. You can toss this, you know, in pastas. You could sort of put it over fish before or after you cook it. I like to give it some acidity, so vinegar, a tablespoon, goes in. Once you've kind of got to a stage like that, which doesn't look dissimilar to a pesto, what you can do is use just a little bit of boiling water, and that will just stretch the sauce more, and that's it. Have a little taste. Oh! Whoa! Vibrant, tangy, garlicky. It's smooth and chunky, all in one. And that lovely, vibrant sauce on your roast chicken will be amazing. So, the room smells incredible. Chicken's done. It's had just over an hour and a quarter. Oh, just look at that. You've got this beautiful stock that's cooked out of the base of that chicken. Have a look at these spuds. See how they've stuck to the side? And if I just peel it and coax it away, this is pot roasted potato, right? So it's really crispy here. And then if you just bust it, it's fluffy on the inside. Oh, the flavor is amazing. Really, really good. So look, at this point in the game, you can baste the chicken like that. And it just smells so incredible. You've got the garlic here. If I just squeeze one,
Can you see how this little clove comes out? Like that. And it's so pearly white. Slightly burning my finger, but it's worth it. If you eat it, mild. Mmm. Creamy. Perfumed. So that is a brilliant way to cook the garlic. And then it's really nice to put just a little bit of this amazing sauce, just a little bit, over the breast like that. Look at the colour. That, my friends, is a beautiful dish. Let's get the chicken out. One of the advantages of cooking like this is when you keep the extra humidity in the pan, you guarantee, you know, more moisture in the chicken. So let's just take off this little leg. Look, just watch how tender this is. It's literally just gonna fall apart. See, it's just absolutely melt in your mouth. It's dripping with juice. So fully cooked, fully tender. Just do a traditional carve. Look at that. So let's just serve it up. Let's take a nice little thigh there. You can see it feels like an exciting thing that you can bring to the table. Put that over the meat, look at that, come on. Right, enough talking. Let's have a little try. Let's try some of that salsa. Salsa and chicken first. Oh. I just love that sauce. The tang from the vinegar. The hazelnuts, they're so good with the parsley and the garlic. I need a clove. Okay, now we're talking. The ultimate mouthful. Potato, chicken, green sauce, whole garlic clove in here. Mmm. This is a great value dish because you get so much flavour out of five ingredients. What are you waiting for? Try that cooking method, give it some love and care, and pull out the big flavours of the Mediterranean. Beautiful pasta carbonara. One of the most loved pastas in the whole wide world, and one that I'm definitely asked about more than any other. I'm gonna get you as close to the classic technique as possible, and I'm gonna give you a nice little surprise for ingredient number five. We're transforming these five ingredients into the perfect midweek pasta meal. It's carbonara, but with an additional twist. This dish already knows how to make a party from simple ingredients, so I'm extending the invite to get some veg involved to make a gorgeous meal for four lucky people. So let's talk about pasta. Now, you might have had carbonara with spaghetti, very delicious, but actually more classic than that would be penne or bucatini, which is like a spaghetti with a little hole through it. I'm gonna use penne. I've got a pan of boiling water. This one takes 10 minutes. We're gonna go in with 300 grams of the pasta, beautiful. And then we're gonna season that with salt. Right, let's talk about the other classic ingredients. Fresh eggs, lovely. Then guanciale. Guanciale, what is it? It is basically the cheek of pork, which they cure and they dry age it and it's incredible. So what's the nearest thing to that? Well, pancetta, right? You can get that in the supermarkets, brilliant. And the nearest thing to that, smoked bacon. That's what I'm gonna use today. It's got the smoke and it's got enough of that fattiness that's gonna give you that beautiful texture and flavor. Then onto the cheese. So the classic would be pecorino, right? But actually I'm gonna use Parmesan today because I think it's more accessible, right? But both cheeses are very good. So they are the four fundamental ingredients of a classic carbonara. Now look, as this has come to the boil, lid will come off. Let's give it a nice little stir so nothing sticks together. And let's get cooking. I'm gonna start by being controversial in the sense of I'm gonna add
a veg. This is not classic at all. I'm going to use some lovely asparagus. Why? Because it cooks really quickly. Because it's sweet and delicious. Because it contrasts the salty, smoky, savoury flavours, right? But it doesn't have to be fresh asparagus. It could be sprout and broccoli. It could be some lovely thin slices of courgette. I want you to be able to react to what's in season and help get more of the good stuff into you. So, look, whatever veg you choose, what I would encourage you to do is to cut it to around the same size as this pasta, right? So, let's just lay it there as a little bit of a kind of guide. I'm just going to cut the asparagus stalk at a slight angle. And you don't have to do it one spear at a time. You can take a whole bunch and speed up the process. But what I do like is you can kind of adjust that classic recipe, but make it work texturally. When you go to eat it, it all kind of works nicely together. OK, so pasta cooking. Let's start frying things. So, take your bacon. And I'm just going to thinly slice it. I'm going to go into the pan with a little oil. And then we want to render the fat out of the bacon and get it nice and golden. So while that's happening, I want to do my egg sauce. Take 4 eggs and very carefully crack them into a bowl. And then what I'm going to do is remove the yolk, leaving behind the white. So the yolk here is delicate, it's rich, and that's what's going to thicken this sauce. So what I'm going to do first of all is save those egg whites, put them in the freezer. Fantastic for cocktails or meringues, and that will be for another day. So now if we look in the pan, it's getting nice and golden and crispy, and I want to give you a nice convincing amount of black pepper now. Right, so about a teaspoon, like you gotta mean it. So as this just simmers beautifully, let's finish this sauce. So I'm gonna take the Parmesan, a little handful is all I need. Now, just whip it up. The egg yolks are silky and they're rich, and the Parmesan has got fats in it. It's got delicious flavor. I'm gonna steal just a little bit of cooking water, right, just a little bit in here, and just stir it in, just to make it a little bit smoother and softer. And I'll put it to one side. So if you look in the pan now, you can see the bacon is nice and dark. We're gonna go in with the asparagus. 1 minute is all you need to cook those in a lovely way. So look, things get quite specific now, right? Eggs cook really quick. We do not want scrambled egg, okay? So I'm now going to turn the heat of this pan off. I'm then going to take the pasta and some of this water into this pan, right? And we'll go in with the penne. And we're going to just shake it around. And if you're not confident shaking, just use a spoon. Now, if you listen, can you hear that? It's still frying. So you want this pan to cool down. If you put that egg sauce in there now, it would scramble. You want to just leave it for 1 minute. So get a nice big platter. We don't want it to be really thick. We want it to be silky and gorgeous. Then we're going to go in with the sauce like that. And it's that residual heat that gives you the classic sauce. Look at that. It's just beautiful. Silky smooth. Elegant. And then to finish, just one little stroke, Parmesan on top. Come on. And one last little flourish of black pepper. Penne carbonara, this time with a little asparagus. Right, let's plate some up. Oh, look at that. Come on. I loved it when I was a kid. I love it as an adult. Mmm. The flavour is massive. You got the savouriness and the smokiness of the bacon. But in contrast, the sweetness, the nuttiness of the asparagus is really good. So classic, no. Clever, I think yes. Mmm. Go on, have a go at that.
I think having a really good sauce recipe up your sleeve is a brilliant way to transform veggies, meat dishes, fish dishes, and this one is a right winner dinner.
Using just 5 ingredients, I've got an exciting way to cook the most delicious cauliflower with my super easy version of an outrageous Spanish sauce. With just a handy jar of roasted peppers, bread, garlic and smoked almonds, my Cheats Romesco sauce helps deliver massive flavour to this brilliant side dish from such a small shopping list.
So we're going to roast off this cauliflower and make it utterly delicious. Roasting veggies, it's brilliant. Squash, carrots, parsnips, cauliflower, broccoli. You know, you can extract more flavour by roasting.
The first thing we do is, like, hack off all the leaves. So we'll just take the worst of those outer leaves off. We'll trim the root off, like that. And then I'm not going to throw these leaves away. They're going to roast up a treat. I'm going to cut this cauliflower in half. And then I'm going to cut through the stalk so it holds it all together into little 3-centimetre chunks. Now, the more surface area we've got, the more it can take on flavour, seasonings and mop up that incredible Cheats Romesco sauce. Next up, let's dress our cauliflower before we roast them. Olive oil into a tray. Just a couple of tablespoons goes in and then a couple of tablespoons of red wine vinegar. We're going to hit it up with some basic seasoning. So we're going to take some salt and then some black pepper. And once you've done that, fingers, and just mix it all up. And that is the welcome party to our beautiful veggies. Give it a little toss around. It actually smells amazing. So in the oven we go for 35 minutes, and that oven is at 180 degrees Celsius, so it's a nice temperature to cook the cauliflower, but also colour it. Now, let's talk about Romesco sauce. This is a mighty sauce. It's from Spain. The old recipe was tomatoes, garlic, and these little round peppers they've got that sun-dry, that are amazing and sweet, and hazelnuts. And they'd thicken it with stale bread, and it was delicious. But in the world of 5 ingredients, we need to be clever. We need to work hard. So I have got some jarred peppers here. These are a brilliant thing to have in your store cupboard because they give you big flavour fast. Next up, the classic Romesco sauce had nuts in it. So here I've got a pack of blanched almonds, but there's also a little option for a swap out. I just want to get you thinking. So in a different section of the supermarket, you're going to find nuts that you'll have with a drink, and these are smoked almonds. These are roasted, they're also seasoned. I'm doing little cheats, right? This is a Cheats Romesco. Now, to thicken the sauce, classically, bread. So just take a couple of slices, and then garlic. Let's give it a little crack. Get yourself 4 cloves of garlic, cut them in half, and put the garlic on the bread, and I'm going to put it straight into the oven. And in like 10-15 minutes, you'll have a bit of colour on both, and this will be a fantastic addition to our Cheats Romesco. First up, we're going to go in with half the nuts, OK? So about 30 grams. Then we're going to go in with these beautiful peppers. The whole jar, juice and all. Get it in there. And then the toasted garlic and bread. Oh, it smells amazing. The cauliflower, let it keep roasting. So what I'm going to do is just go in there with this. I'm going to put 1.5 slices of the bread in. We'll hit it up with just a little bit of salt and pepper, a tiny thimble of red wine vinegar, about a tablespoon. And then we're going to go in with some olive oil. So a couple of tablespoons goes in. Whiz this up, and beautiful things are going to happen. Look at that. The colour is amazing. Let's have a little taste. Oh. Whoa! With the smoked almonds, that is another level of delicious. I'm going to take this little bit of bread and this little handful of leftover nuts, and these are going to be sprinkles. So literally just chop them up. We want flavour, texture, crunch. That sauce is one of the smoothest, most delicious, shiny, silky things I've had for a long time. Just pour that onto a platter. But look at that. It is absolutely beautiful. Cold, silky, smooth, sweet, tangy. Roasted. Cauliflower with attitude. Have a look at that. See how the leaves have gotten really crispy? How cool is that? So let's just plate this up.
So you can do this as a veggie dish. You can do this as a side dish. Big flavour. Really, really good.
You've got some burnt bits and you've got some perfect bits. I love it. Here we are, a big old stack of cauliflower and gnarly ends. And then you've got those nuts and the bread just on the top like that. Bosh.
Right, let's just serve a little bit up.
Let's go for the sauce first. This sauce you will never regret learning to make.
So, enough yapping. Let's try some.
Get amongst it.
Wow. Roasting the cauliflower like that just creates so much more texture, soft and crunchy, and a depth of flavour, a different flavour. And the leaves, they kind of cook up, almost like seaweed. It's almost got a meaty flavour. And that sauce, well, life is just better with this sauce in it. So what are you waiting for? Go on. Easy. Whiz it up. I love it. Some recipes are just genius and they come together so well. This one is five ingredients that are such a good combination. Really surprising. You might not have seen anything like this before, but so delicious and really quick to do. Once you've done it once, you'll be doing it time and time again. I'm transforming this handful of ingredients into my utterly delicious feta phyllo turnovers. One of my favourite and easiest combinations, stuffing shop-bought phyllo pastry with crumbly feta cheese and topping it with runny honey and pistachio sprinkles. They're perfect for a super quick snack or starter. This recipe kind of came from a bunch of tests and mistakes, and when I got it, I'm like, oh my goodness, that's so good. It's nice because it's using a handful of, you know, very accessible things, honey, great store cupboard ingredient. I got some nuts, pistachio, but you could change it up for hazelnuts, almonds, things like that. I've got some herb, which today I'm going to use marjoram because I love it so much, but it could be oregano, it could be dill, it could be parsley or basil. Next up, there's a great little ingredient that you can get in the fridge or the freezer, and that is phyllo pastry. And I'm going to stuff it with feta. Great cheese, keeps really well. So look, here are our five little ingredients. So I've got a large pan, non-stick, whack it onto a medium heat. I've got the phyllo here, and it's really easy to use, but you have to work fast. Get yourself a clean tea towel, right? Put it under the tap. Phyllo pastry is so delicate that it'll dry very quickly. And if you work on a damp cloth, then the chances of the phyllo pastry drying out is minimised massively. So, let's just talk about phyllo pastry. It's a very fine, paper-thin pastry, but what you get is delicate crunch, 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 like little shards of pastry. You can go sweet, you can go savoury. So, damp cloth, pop it on a board. We'll unroll it. Just get yourself one sheet, that's all you need. You can line moulds, it can be sort of folded and moulded, and it's quite malleable until it starts to dry. Always covering your phyllo back up again, so you're protecting it. We're going to use a little bit of olive oil. So just brush up the pastry like that. This is going to just crispen up in the most beautiful way. Then I'm going to take a quarter of that pack of feta cheese, and I'm just going to sprinkle it just to one side like this. Not quite to the end. What we're going to do is take a couple of sprigs of herb. So marjoram in this case, because it's so fragrant. I'm just going to take this little bit of pastry and fold it over into a quarter like that, pat it down gently, fold it up again and again. I'm going to take a bit more oil and then just brush it on the outside
And that's ready and raring to go. So let's repeat. Ultimately, crispy stuff around cheesy stuff is a beautiful thing. If you've got mates come around for a dinner party, throw this in as a little newbie. You can do it in the morning, pop them in the fridge, and then when they turn up, all casual, pop the pan on, fry it off, brown it off, 4 minutes, honey, pistachios, little drink, and that'll be the thing they talk about the next day. Last one. Look at that. Kind of like a stained glass window. Absolutely beautiful. You can see everything inside it, and that's all going to melt and get crispy. Right, let's cook these, because they're fun. This pan, it's not really, really hot. I'll just take a little bit of this oil. I'm just going to put that in the pan, like that. 2 minutes each side is all you need to do. So while this pastry is doing its magic, handful of pistachios. What I like to do is pound up part of this so it's like almost powder, and then have a few nice chunks to go with it. So look at that. That's what we want. Okay, I can smell these are ready to turn. You can hear the crunch. They'll be lightly, perfectly golden and crisp. The feta's just gonna ooze. Right, let's plate this up. Look at that. While it's still warm, just sort of fold it back on itself and let it crack. And then while it's doing its thing, I can put these in to cook the second batch. And then at this point, we're gonna get honey and do it from a height like that. A nice little kind of drizzle of the pistachios. And then a little secret curveball is a pinch of black pepper. And that heat, and that tang, the salt, the sugar, the nuts, the crunch, that is a mouthful. And when these have had enough time just to cool down, then that is the time to have a little try. Tear that. Let's just mop it in the honey. Oh. Hallelujah. Mmm. The crunch, just so good. Wow. It's hot, it's messy. And it's utterly delicious. When I'm sharing these 5-ingredient meals, I want to save you time. I want to save you long shopping lists. Easy, simple food. Get you to get value out of delicious ingredients. Wow. Yum.
Using a handful of ingredients in clever ways can get incredible flavour. And chefs who do that brilliantly are Married Couple, Sarit Packer and Itamar Shulevich. With 3 restaurants, 4 cookery books and a podcast to their name, they're renowned for serving up Middle Eastern food that's simply spectacular.
We got something so delicious that we're going to cook with you guys. Spicy, creamy.
A bit crispy, hot, really fulfilling, and only with 5 ingredients.
You won't believe it's 5 ingredients.
And vegetarian.
And vegetarian.
I mean, come on.
With a few store cupboard staples and some simple ingredients that you can find in the supermarket, they're knocking up a mushroom sfeha. Combining onions, mushrooms, ricotta, and a Middle Eastern spice mix to make this exciting midweek meal that's packed full of flavour.
Let's start cooking. All right, onions, because that's the basis of everything. Will you peel some for me?
Yes, of course.
Onions give a lot of kind of sweetness and richness and moisture to any kind of dish. Will you get a pan on the stove for me as well?
Yeah, for sure.
And we're just going to sauté these in, like, loads of olive oil to give them all that flavour we want. Oh, I'm crying so badly.
Started already.
Come on, one more to go.
The oil is nicely sizzling.
Let's chuck them all in. And actually, you almost always want to cook them longer than you think until they're really soft, really caramelised. And then you want some mushrooms. These are chestnut, but use whichever one you fancy. And quite nice thick chunks, because we want this to be really meaty.
So this dish, the specha, is, you know, it comes from Lebanon, Syria, that sort of part of the world. It's usually made with meat, but using the mushrooms instead of the meat is a really good vegetarian. It's not a substitute because the mushrooms are gorgeous by themselves.
It's also a cheaper solution, isn't it, than meat, actually?
Yeah, yeah.
How are my onions looking?
I think they're looking really, really good.
Ooh, good colour. And smelling really nice.
Smelling just super sweet and gentle and delicious.
And then you throw in loads of mushrooms.
Yeah.
It looks like loads, but this is going to cook down. It's not going to be that much.
As the mushroom cook down, you know, they put out all the liquid and they sort of cook in it and really intensify in flavours.
It's going to take another 10 to 12 yeah. minutes, really cook them down. It's going to help them get really kind of delicious and sweet and yeah. chewy.
It's really, really starting to smell that mushroomy deliciousness.
And we go to the best part of it.
The cheat.
It's kind of a cheat, but a good cheat. You know, like you would buy a pack of pastry, you could also buy a pack of flatbreads. The main thing you have to do is give them some moisture because they tend to be a bit dry, but a bit of warm water, get them wetter than you think probably, and they'll come back to life. It's like a miraculous thing bread has. If you give it moisture and heat, it comes back to life. You can try it with an old loaf of bread as well. So grab me a tin, hun.
Yeah.
And a bit of baking paper, a bit of oil just to catch my paper because I don't want it moving around. And then a bit of oil on my bread. Flip it and press it down. All right, so our case is ready to go. How are my mushrooms doing?
Mushrooms are looking
Bring them
spot
over.
On. They're kind of glossy. They smell amazing.
Oh, they smell so good.
Sticky, so delicious. They just need a little bit of punch.
A whole lot of spice.
A whole lot of
Not
spice.
A little bit of spice, a whole lot of spice. We're gonna use baharat spice. And baharat spice is a pre-made mix. And using, oh, it smells delicious. Using a pre-made spice mix is the best thing to do because it gives you a whole load of a range of flavors. And don't be shy, it needs like a good 2 tablespoons to get everything going here.
So this will have cumin, coriander, cinnamon, chili, paprika, so many different spices. So you don't need to go and buy individually. You just buy this tiny little jar and you can use it on a million things. Something like this can take your cooking to a whole different place.
You also want to add a bit of salt here, which I'm going to sprinkle in. That's delicious.
Last ingredient?
Last ingredient. Ingredient number 5. So I'm going to grab some ricotta.
The ricotta is going to bring it that sort of creaminess, a little bit of tang, a little bit of freshness, and it's going to bring it all together.
Just dollop most of it into our little bread basket, and we're going to spread it around. I'm going to leave a bit for later for serving it.
Tip all of that glorious mushroom filling in.
And then, because we've moistened this bread before, it's really nice and soft, we're kind of going to fold it in just to create a little bit of a pie. Bit of olive oil.
So all we need is to give it 10 minutes in the oven
yeah,
just to
hot
crisp
oven.
Up.
180 until it's crispy and warm and delicious.
Something smells right.
Yum. Oh, the smell is amazing.
Mm. You know it's gonna be delicious.
You just lift it off and onto your table so you can easily slice it. Look at this beauty. Just flip your tin and then just slide it off. Paper's gone, tin is gone.
Nice. And we have the ricotta that we saved from before. We're just gonna season it with a bit of pepper. So hot pie, cold ricotta.
All right, let's go for it. Ooh, listen to the crunch.
Nice sounding crunch. Too gorgeous.
Too gorgeous. Mmm. So good. I'm going in for a crispy bit.
Mmm, beautiful.
Tastes delicious. Mmm. The spice is coming through really well. And it's so hearty as well. 5 ingredients, you get a meal that you feel is fully substantial.
Yeah.
So good.
Creamy, crunchy, mushroomy, sweet
spicy,
onion, tons
delish.
Of spice. This, for me, is the essence of Mediterranean food. Perfect.
Everyone deserves a delicious treat, and this one is loved by adults and kids alike. And I've got a nice little hack for this beautiful icy treat.
We're transforming this handful of ingredients into cheeky, fun little lollipops. Using fruit, chocolate, sprinkles, and an unexpected tinned ingredient. These are delicious sweet treats that are something truly special.
In our house, making some delicious lollies is something that we've done a lot for many, many years. The kids love them, but I have to be honest, I really love them as well. But there's a few little tricks that I want to give you that might surprise you. First one, an old friend that my nan would have loved. Rice pudding, vanilla rice pudding. Go over to a liquidizer and we're gonna whiz it up. I'll tell you why, because my favorite ice cream in Italy is a rice pudding ice cream. So if they can do it, why can't we? This is a nice little store cupboard item. We'll whiz it up. So in just 30 seconds, we've made a beautiful, silky vanilla sauce. So I'm gonna put half of this mix in as a layer here. So this will be enough to make 8. And then what I'm gonna do is just get a little bowl and put the rest of that in here. So I'm gonna do a layer of vanilla rice pudding custard, and then I'm gonna do a layer of this and strawberry, and then a pure layer of just strawberry. I'm just gonna give it a quick little rinse. So first layer into the freezer. And that won't take long to freeze. It's only an inch. So what I need to do is just grab a little knife. I like to make it with fruit that might be on the edge of being almost too ripe. You can turn it into a really delicious layer of a lolly. Now I've got a little secret ingredient, which is like an optional extra. And this is rose water, right? You can get it in the supermarket. It's in the baking aisle. So half a teaspoon. What we have to do now is whiz this up again. So another 30 seconds. We're gonna put half in with that vanilla mixture. Mix it up and kind of have a nice little mixed in layer. So let's get that first layer. It doesn't have to be like frozen all the way through, but enough to stop one layer mixing with the other. Look at the color of that. That smells amazing. So there you go. All I need now is some little sticks. So just try and poke it into the layer below. So look, we're nearly there. 3/4 there, guys. Back in the freezer. So let's get this frozen layer out. We're building the layers. Let's do that last little amount. Yum, pure strawberry with that little hit of rose water. I always do a little bit of every one first, just in case there's not enough to do all of them, because I've caught myself out before. And then you get a kid with one short layer and they get like a bit upset. And to be honest, it's not just the kids. Right, last layer done. This is gonna go into the freezer. Same old, freeze it up. Love it. So, while that's doing its thing, 100 grams of chocolate, about that much. And I'm just gonna crack this into a bowl. And the bowl is on a pan with about a centimeter of water. So on a very low heat, I'm gonna slowly melt this chocolate so I can drizzle it over our lollipops. And then over here, I've got the fifth ingredient. I've got beautiful sprinkles here. Look at these colors. So my kids go mad for that. So these are all frozen up, but what you can do is just pop them under a warm tap just for a couple of seconds. And then they're just gonna pop out. Look at that. Let's pop all of these out. So then we can dip these lollies in chocolate, just a cheeky centimeter. and then dip this into these sprinkles. Look at that. Then we can come over with our chocolate here, and from a height, just get a little bit of a strand going on and just go kind of crazy paving. The minute that the chocolate hits the ice cream, it's going to set. I love it. Also, if you've got a little bit of chocolate, you can just shave bits over the top like that. So all of these are going back in the freezer until I give it the big reveal. And now it's just me left with this. Mmm. Very, very delicious. I just love it. The rice pudding is so creamy. And it's like kind of coats your mouth. And then you get into that second layer where you get that little kick of the sour fruit, that little bit of bitterness from the chocolate as well. And then let's have a little bit of the last layer. Yeah, cream, sour, and that little mystery taste of the rose water. Utterly delicious.